Today, in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now, it's good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. We welcome our visitors. And we appreciate you that's tuned out in the radio listen audience to this program. We appreciate you tuning in, and if you'll tell others about it and have them to tune in and get this good hour, we'd appreciate it so very much. You can do that by phone in the next minute or so, and I hope you will. And so we welcome every one of you, and may the Lord bless you. Now, the tape and the singing today, the entire message and singing and music will be on cassette tape. And it'll be tape number 188. If you'd like to write in and get the tape, you can. We send it out for a gift of $3. And the gift is used to help defray our radio expense. So why don't you write in and get the tape? We'll send you a list of our tape. We'll send you a list of at least 186 tape. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. Now, if you're not getting our daily broadcast, if you tune to the station where you're now listening each day at 12 o'clock noon, Monday through Saturday, you can get the broadcast. We're heard 7 days a week. God spares us through next month, and that'll bring a completion of 37 years of daily broadcasting from the classic city of Athens, Georgia. So you can see this is not a fly-by-night ministry. And we covet your prayers. It's a real home mission work. And you'll be surprised at the dear, precious, shut-in people that look forward to this radio ministry through the week and on Sunday as well. And you pray for us. Write to us. Stand by us. Why don't you write in and get one of our brochures for our proposed Holy Land tour for next year? We're planning on a tour to Israel and Rome, and just write in and say, Preach Edward, send me the brochure on the Holy Land tour. Now's the time to take a look at it, get your name on the list, make plans to go. You might want to send a friend, send your pastor, send your pastor and his wife. You might want to do something for somebody by sending them to the Holy Land. No greater thing you could do for a Christian than to do that. We had a young couple 1 year, and they were so enthused and thrilled until the man felt God called him to preach, and he surrendered to preach, and he's now preaching. He's finished Bob Jones University and now preaching the gospel, and I believe the preaching comes as a result of his making a tour to the Holy Land when God really spoke to him. So you never know what's accomplished in the hearts of people when they make this tour. Pastors are never the same. They're more blessed, deep in the scripture, greater knowledge of God's word and historical facts as a result of the trip. So whenever you have a part in sending someone, you're doing a great deed. Turn to Exodus chapter 12. The book of Exodus chapter 12, page 83. You know, oftentimes parents talk and say things around their children and never think about the little fellow standing there with both ears wide open. Remember the story of this grandmother, the man's wife's mother, came driving up for the weekend. And the little grandson met her at the door, and he is so excited and greatly enthused about it. She said, son, why are you so happy? Why are you so enthused? He said, Grandma, I've never been so proud to see you in all my life. I want to see my daddy do it. She said, what do you mean? He said, well, my daddy said if you come over here this weekend, he's going to climb the wall backwards, and I'd just like to see him do it. So he's greatly thrilled about that. Now, you have to be careful what you say around children. They're liable to tell on you. Amen? Amen. All right, Exodus chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak you unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make you account for the lamb, wherein they shall eat it. They shall eat the flesh. In that night roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat none of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs with the pertinence thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain unto the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall you eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. But I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both men and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be to you as a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you, destroy you, when I smite the land of Egypt. Now that's reading from the book of Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 through 13. I want to speak to you today on this subject, the Passover Lamb, a type of Christ, our Redeemer. Now I want to read a couple other verses if you want to turn there. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, page 1216. I'll be reading from page 1216. I want to read verses 7 and 8. Purge out therefore the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, as you are unleavened. Even Christ our Passover sacrificed for us. Let us keep the feast not with old leaven, neither with leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Now if you notice here in verse 7, he said Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Now I want to read a couple of other verses found in 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1, and it's page 1312, beginning with verse 18. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb, without blemish and without spot. And so today I want us to take a look at the Passover lamb, how it is a type of Christ Jesus, our Redeemer. Now Christ is the Lamb of God. We know that he's called the Lamb of God. John the Baptist said in John chapter 1 and verse 29, Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. And then when Abraham had Isaac on top of Mount Moriah and about ready to sacrifice him on the altar, and God stayed his hand, and God said he would prepare himself a lamb, speaking about the coming Savior. And so he stayed Abraham's hand from slaying his son Isaac. There was a ram caught in the thicket that died in his place. So Jesus Christ is the Passover lamb as far as we are concerned. In Old Testament days, they would have to kill a little lamb, a little goat. I was reading some time ago about this dear man, picked up a little lamb. He was to kill that little lamb. It was real small, and he was to kill it for some reason or another. He was to cut its little throat, and there he took his knife, and he took that little innocent lamb in his arm. And just before he came to the table where he was to slay the little lamb, the little lamb turned up and looked at him with tender eyes and then licked his hand. He said, I couldn't kill that lamb. I couldn't do it for anything in the world. It looked so innocent and so loving. It wanted to lick my hand before I took its little life. He said, I just couldn't do it. Now, Jesus Christ is God's lamb, and he was slain before the foundation of the world. He died on Calvary's cross. And for the Passover, it was a lamb in Old Testament days. The Bible says in Exodus chapter 12 and verse 3, speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the tenth day of the month they shall take them every man a lamb according to the house of their father, a lamb for a house. Now we know a lamb is a picture of innocence. A little lamb is innocent. It's not guilty of doing major wrongs. And a little lamb is harmless. No doubt about that. And a little lamb has meekness and non-resistance. And so in this sense, we see a picture of Jesus. He was innocent. He never did anything wrong. He was harmless. He never really harmed anyone. And he was meek and, of course, non-resistant. Whenever they arrested him, they had to try him and put him to death. And all these lambs throughout the Old Testament point forward to the great Lamb, the Son of God. Secondly, the lamb was to be taken out and set aside on the 10th day, but was not to be killed until the 14th day. Now those Israelite fathers, it was their responsibility to go and select a little innocent lamb and take it out and put it up. And they would keep that lamb up for a period of time. It was set aside on the 10th day. And so after it was set aside on the 10th day, it was not killed until 4 days later on the 14th day. Now you must remember the Passover had its beginning in the land of Egypt whenever God sent Moses in to lead out his people. And God said, when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. That's the beginning of the Passover. I will pass over you. And God said, every year I want you to observe this Passover. Now the Orthodox Jew today still observes the Passover every year, not realizing it was fulfilled in Christ and should have ceased when Christ became the Passover lamb. But they didn't believe in Jesus, did not accept him as the Messiah, and they still offer that lamb today. Now these 4 days was to see if the lamb had any flaw or defect. They had to check it out real good. They checked its little legs, its arms, its eyes, its ears, its mouth. They checked it all over. That lamb could not have any defect, no kind of disease, no sore, no wound, no cut place, no marks on it. It had to be a spotless little lamb because it was a type of God's lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ, who was without spot and blemish. Now, in its typical importance, this speaks of two specific things. The eternal foreordination of Jesus Christ to the death of the cross. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 20 and Revelation chapter 13 and verse 8 that before the foundation of the world, God's Lamb, the Lord Jesus, was slain in the mind of God the Father. That was done before God laid the foundation of the planet Earth. Jesus Christ died in the mind of God, was slain in the mind and heart of God. He was God's Lamb before the foundation of the world. He came, when he came to the earth, to fulfill that was planned before the foundation of the world. Now, the testing of Jesus Christ in his earthly life, whereby he gave evidence and proof of his wholeness, his sinlessness, and perfection. Nobody could find anything wrong with Jesus. There was no sin in his life. He was a perfect man. There was no disease in his body. There was no broken bones about him. He was a picture of health, if you please. There was no spot in his flesh anywhere. He was a perfect man. Now that little lamb that was put up for 10 days and examined for 4 days had to be a spotless lamb pointing forward to God's Lamb, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Lord was kept up that he might be fully examined. Now what I mean by that is, Jesus Christ came down to this earth and he was fully examined by man, known of course by the Father, and they found no wrong in him. 7 times the governor Pontius Pilate said, I find no fault in him. Judas Iscariot said, I have betrayed the innocent blood. Simon Peter said, this man is innocent. He found no fault in him. And so others said that. The centurion said, truly this must have been the Son of God. Nobody could find any fault in Jesus. Now they had false accusers. They had liars. They had those that testified against him, accused him of saying things he did not say, failed to understand what he did say, and brought those accusations against him, but he was perfect from the cradle to the grave. Number 3, a lamb was to be taken by each house. There in the land of Egypt, each individual hut had to have its own lamb. Exodus chapter 12 and verse 3, every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house. Each house had to have that lamb. Now God said, I'm passing through with a death angel tonight. And when I pass by your house, if I see blood on the doorpost on either side and the upper lintel, I'll pass over your house. Now the reason for the blood on the side post upper lintel is it formed a cross. Blood in Christ's hands, blood on his forehead. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And so they had to have the lamb slain, the blood shed, placed in a basin, and some hyssop used to spot it on the doorpost and upper lintel. This reminds us that God is concerned about the entire family. Now, I want you to let this sink deep down into your ears. God is concerned about families. God is concerned about the entire family. God is far more concerned about your entire family getting in and going to heaven than you are. God doesn't want just part of your family in heaven and part in hell. God wants all of your family in heaven. And God will help you get your family in if you pray about it and work at it and be patient and long-suffering. God can help you get your family, and God is deeply concerned about that family. Now, God said to those Hebrew fathers, I want you to see to it that every member of your family is in the house. The story is told about a little girl, and the Bible says the firstborn must die, and they were informed about that. God said, if I pass through and there's no blood, that firstborn, that's a type of the Adamic nature, that firstborn must die. And that was a little girl. She was the oldest child. And she kept worrying her father. She said, Daddy, are you sure that you put blood on the doorpost and up a lintel? Oh, he said, yes, daughter, I did that. She said, I know, sir, but you've been busy. I haven't seen you doing it. Daddy, did you really do it? He said, yes. She said, Daddy, would you please go and check and be sure? And he went out the door, and it's just about a minute or so before the death angels to come by, and he noticed he hadn't done it. He hadn't. He thought he had, but he hadn't. And some reason or other, that little girl had a feeling that was not done. Now, you need to be sure and need to know that you know that the blood's been applied. Not think so, maybe so, hope so, but know that. And so he's concerned about the house. In Acts chapter 16 and verse 31, they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thy house. See, here we have the old Philippian jailer saved, and then he carried the preacher's home with him. His whole family got saved. They had a baptized. He baptized them, and they fixed him a supper. And all night long, they praised God and thanked God for what God had done. God is concerned about families. I know some of you might be discouraged about some members of your family. I have loved ones I've been praying for more than 40 years. But I haven't stopped. I don't want them to go to hell. I want them to be saved. I pray for them. If they die and go to hell, it won't be because I haven't prayed for them. I've witnessed to them. I've invited them to Jesus. And God wants us to do that, but be patient and persistent and continue on trying. And after you've done all you can do, if they die and fall into the flames of burning hell, where they be tormented forever, you have done what you could do. And that's all you can do, but God expects you to do that. Number four, the lamb was to be without blemish. Verse 5 of Exodus 12, your lamb should be without blemish. Christ had to be without blemish. There could not be one blemish, not one sin, not one spot, not anything wrong with Jesus in any way. He was perfect from the cradle to the grave. He had in his veins the blood of God. He had in his body there that God Almighty had placed there in the womb of Mary. God performed that body. A body hast thou prepared me, O God, he said in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 5, I believe it is. Anyway, Jesus had a special built body. It was protected from all kind of sin by the Holy Spirit of God while it was being formed in the womb of Mary. God's own blood ran in his veins. He was perfect. He had perfect blood. He had a perfect body. And he never committed a sin. He was the perfect lamb, the only perfect person that ever lived. Number five, the lamb was to be a male of the first year. The Bible says in verse 5, a male of the first year. This meant the firstborn. So was Christ. Jesus Christ was the firstborn in the home of Mary and Joseph. He was a male and the firstborn according to the Bible. In Colossians chapter 1, verses 14 and 15, says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God and firstborn of every creature. So Jesus Christ was the firstborn according to the Bible here in this home. He had to be to fulfill the Old Testament type. Then we come to number six, and that is the whole congregation was to take part in the slaying of the lamb. When that Hebrew father gathered that little innocent lamb, the whole family had to take part in it, every one of them. In Exodus chapter 12 and verse 6, and you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. The whole family had to be identified with the death of that lamb. Every last one of them. Couldn't be the one left out. They had to be identified with that lamb. All Israel in the world is guilty of the death of Jesus Christ. Just as those people, the whole family, put their approval and identified themselves with the death of that little innocent lamb. The whole world, Israel and all the Gentiles, every person that's been born in this world, helped put Jesus on the cross. Your sins, my sins, everybody's sins from Adam to the end of the millennium, God placed on the Son of God on Calvary. He carried every one of them on Calvary. He was hanging there between heaven and earth. God took all the sins that's ever committed, starting with Adam and Eve, right on down through this period of time, right on through the future, right on to the end of the millennium. The last sin ever committed at the millennium, at the end of the millennium, every last one of them God brought from the beginning to the end, to the present at that time, and placed them on Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he paid the sin debt completely, and every human being ever born on the earth had part in that, and partly responsible for crucifying the Son of God, or him being crucified. When Simon and Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost and said to those people, "You have crucified the King of Glory. You have killed the Prince of Life." Of course they didn't like that. They didn't want to be accused of putting Jesus to death. But they were guilty. We are guilty. Everybody's guilty. Every sinner's guilty because of all sin and comes short of the glory of God. And he had to pay the sin debt for everyone. The Bible said he tasted death for every man. Jesus didn't die for just a few. Jesus didn't die just for the elect. Jesus died for everybody. He tasted death for every man. And you need to realize that. So you're guilty and I'm guilty. He was a lamb who was slain for us, and we put him there on the cross. Our sins did that. Number 7, the lamb was to be killed in the evening. In Exodus chapter 12 and verse 6, the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. Our Lord died in the evening, or if you want to call it the afternoon. Jesus died about 3 o'clock in the afternoon between 12 and 6. That Jesus gave up the ghost. This lamb that they killed had to be killed in the evening, not in the early morning, not at noontime, but afternoon, in the evening that it was killed. Number 8, the lamb was to be slain and roasted with fire. The Bible says in verses 8 and 9 of Exodus 12, "And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire, unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat it not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs and with the pertinence thereof." And so when they took the blood from that little innocent lamb and placed it on the doorpost up a little, then they take the rest of the meat, and there they roast that, and they sit in the house behind that protective blood, and there they engage in a good meal. Now that's a picture of your fellowship with the Lord. After Jesus shed his blood, paid your sin debt, you come to know God, then you eat of the roasted lamb. That is, when you feed upon the Word of God, you're feeding upon the roasted lamb, as it were. The blood's already been placed there on the cross. You're protected by that blood. The death angel will not take care of you. You're protected. And now you can eat the roasted lamb. When you come here this morning, as I expound unto you the scriptures, I'm giving you this roasted lamb. You're feeding upon the roasted lamb. You're fellowshipping upon the roasted lamb. You see how important it is for you to be in God's house on Sunday morning. You're a backslidden church member sitting at home today looking at TV, getting around, or maybe some other place out in the yard, maybe working in the garden in the yard, when they ought to be in God's house. It's a shame. And yet you ask them, "Are you going to heaven?" "Oh yes, I'm saved." And they refuse to eat. They refuse to come and take the roasted lamb. They are not strong. They're weak. They're weaklings. And they need to be fed. They need to be in God's house. They need to feed on the roasted lamb, enjoy the fellowship. And our Lord died, the Bible tells us, about the ninth hour. Then number 9, the lamb having been slain, the blood must be applied in Exodus chapter 12, verse 7. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts, the upper door posts of the houses, wherein they shall eat it. The blood must be applied. They could have killed that lamb, left that blood in the basin, never put it on the doorpost. The firstborn would have died that night when God and the death angel came through. But they put the blood on the doorpost and the upper lintel. Now when Jesus died on Calvary's cross, you know what happened? Jesus took some of his blood. He carried that blood into the Holy of Holies in heaven. Jesus placed that blood on the altar. Now that's what the high priest did in Old Testament days. When they'd kill the lamb, the high priest would take the blood into the Holy of Holies. He couldn't go in there without it, so God would kill him. He was the only one who could do it. And he would go behind that curtain to the Holy of Holies, and he would place the blood of that lamb on that altar. And for another year, God would look over the sins of the people. They were being saved as it were on the credit. And God would look over their sins for another year, another year, another year, right on up till Jesus paid the final debt on the cross. Now when Jesus took his own blood and went into heaven and put it on the altar, he perfected forever everyone that believeth. He didn't have to go back every year. There was no need of killing any more lambs or goats. God's lamb had died. God's blood had been applied. And only one time and once forever, Jesus placed that blood on that altar. And it's not to be placed there anymore. No more lambs to be killed. Jesus fulfilled little and minutely that entire type. And then we find another thought, and that is, the blood of the lamb applied apart from anything additional constituted a perfect protection. They didn't need a little water there beside that blood. They didn't need to stick some little wafers up there. They didn't need somebody to say a mass or some apostate preacher to read a poem. That blood was sufficient. And it's the blood of Jesus Christ is sufficient today. Exodus 12, 13, the blood shall be to you for a token upon the house where you are, and when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. He didn't say, when I see the blood and the water. You have a lot of false teachers today that teach you that you have to be saved by the blood and then baptized in the water or you won't go to heaven. You only have about three things born outright in water. That's a tadpole, a muskete, and a camelite. Beloved, you're not saved by water and blood. You're not saved by blood and good works. You don't buy your way in. You're saved by the blood alone. It's the blood that atones for your sin. It was the blood that they saw when they passed through that night. They didn't see a list of good works, some prayers written out, some water in a basin, some wafers. No, no. The blood is all they needed, and that's all they saw. The only thing you need to pardon you from your sins, guarantee you for heaven, is BLOOD, and that is the blood of the Son of God. If you have been saved, you have been redeemed by that blood. And the lamb was to be eaten that night. Exodus 12, 8. They shall eat the flesh that night, roasted fire, unleavened bread with bitter herbs. They shall eat it. And so the eating of the Passover was the duty and privilege of Israel. It was not a means of salvation, but a matter of fellowship for strength. And so the lamb don't have to be killed anymore. He died once and for all. And now we eat, we fellowship on the roasted lamb. That's our privilege. We feed upon Christ. Only those sheltered by the blood can feed upon the lamb. Only those who are saved by the blood of Christ can feed upon Christ. If you're sitting here unsaved, if you're out in the radio listening to all that's unsaved, you can't eat not one bite of this roasted lamb. You can't even chew it up and swallow. You can't take it. You can't assimilate it. Only God's people can feed upon the roasted lamb, which is the word of God. But if you're saved, you can feed upon it, and you should feed upon it, and you should desire and look forward to feeding upon the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Simon Peter said, we redeem not corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of the Lamb, without spot and without blemish. You're saved by the precious blood of the Lamb, without spot and without blemish. There was a little girl one time that went to a tent meeting. Her daddy told her, said, listen, If you go back down to that tent meeting, I'll beat you to death. And she got saved at that tent meeting. She came by, and the temptation's so great, she just had to go in. She went in. God saved her. She came back home. Her daddy found out about it. He almost beat her to death, blooded her body. And she was carried upstairs and put to bed. And she was in a dying condition. And she said, "Mama, could you go get my dress with that blood on it?" She said, "Yes, honey, I can. What you want with it?" She said, "I want it." Mother went and got the old dress. It had been torn and bloodied by the whip of a daddy. Little girl hugged her bosom, said, "Mama, Jesus' blood saved me." And said, "I'm dying, Mom, and I'm going to heaven. Now I want to take my blood on this dress and tell Jesus that blood was put there because I love him and wanted to go and hear the preacher and be saved. And I love him, and I want to show it to Jesus." And she died. Let's stand our feet. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you'd use the message and speak to hearts. We thank you for the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Lord, I pray that somebody today might be saved as a result of this service today. No doubt somebody in this auditorium needs to get saved or come back to God or join the church. Maybe somebody in the radio listening audience. I pray that this message today will be used to your glory and for Christ's sake. Amen. Now listen to me. Debbie is going to play in just a moment. If you're in this building and you're not saved, you want to get saved, you come down here. You can't go to heaven unless you get saved. That blood must be recognized. And if you're backslidden on God, then you need to come back into fellowship. You can't enjoy the roasted lamb out of fellowship with God. If you want to join this church and make this your church home, you come forward, we accept you in, and the way we receive members. While Debbie plays, would you obey the Lord? Just do what God tells you. That's all we ask you. Just do what God tells you. Just come forward and we'll help you. God is speaking. Just come forward and we'll help you.